Mötley Crüe is known for being one of the wildest rock bands in history, but how much of what's seen in Netflix's The Dirt actually happened? In this episode, we're going to look at what's true and what's false in The Dirt. At the beginning of the movie, there's an explicit scene between Tommy Lee and his girlfriend. In the film, Lee is portrayed by Colson Baker, who's better known by his stage name as rapper Machine Gun Kelly. Now, this scene is actually happening a little bit in the future, before the movie flashes back to the beginning of the story. According to the band, the raunchy scene did happen in real life, and they insisted that it be in the movie. In fact, the movie was stuck in development for more than a decade. It was once attached to Paramount and MTV, and one of the reasons it was held up was that raunchy opening scene. Nikki Sixx said that a certain CEO of a certain company refused to make the film if that scene was included. So I don't know if it's more for our benefit or our disgust, but along came Netflix and they told them that the scene could be included and that they would not sanitize the true story. Next, the movie chronicles the formation of Mötley Crüe, and we see Tommy Lee meeting Nikki Sixx by chance at a Donnie's restaurant. In real life, they met at a Denny's restaurant. Lee is with his girlfriend, and they've just come from watching Nikki's band London perform. Nikki tells him that London is breaking up and that he's looking to start a new band. He welcomes Lee to try out to be the drummer, despite Lee implying that his only experience was his high school marching band. This part of the movie is a bit fictional. In reality, Lee was the drummer in a band named Sweet 19, and Nikki had gone to see them in concert and was very impressed. And their encounter at Denny's was not random. It was a planned meeting to talk about putting together a new band. The next inaccuracy is how the band met Vince Neil. In the film, the band meets him at a backyard party where he's singing Billy Squire's My Kind of Lover as a group of women swoon over him. In reality, Billy Squire's My Kind of Lover hadn't even been released yet, and according to the true story, the band first met Vince Neil at the Starwood nightclub in West Hollywood. And they didn't convince him at that first meeting. It actually took several weeks of stalking Neil to convince him to come to a jam session. And when he finally did come to a session, they didn't play Live Wire like in the movie, because Nikki Sixx hadn't even written that song yet. In discussing Vince Neil joining the band, it's certainly worth mentioning that he was not Mötley Crüe's original lead singer. The original lead singer of Mötley Crüe was Odine Peterson. Peterson was part of the band when they recorded their earliest studio demos. He's omitted from the movie, and as the true story goes, the band didn't like his attitude, and Mick Mars felt that he was too much of a hippie to really fit in with Mötley Crüe's persona. On an interesting side note, Odine Peterson still makes occasional appearances in LA, performing as a Mötley Crüe cover artist. As for Mick Mars joining the band, it's accurate what's seen in the movie. He put an ad in the newspaper that said, "Loud, rude, aggressive guitarist," and Nikki Sixx saw the ad and called him. One of the more popular questions we've gotten about the movie is, did Nikki Sixx really call the police on his mom? This is actually true, and the movie lines up with the true story rather well, aside from some minor technicalities. Nikki did have a troubled childhood. He grew up in a broken home, and his father had left when he was young. He went to live with his grandparents after his mother abandoned him, and eventually his grandparents sent him back to live with his mother. They fought a lot, and after one of their arguments, Nikki threw his stereo and damaged the TV. He went and borrowed a knife from a neighbor and began to stab himself above his elbow, sinking the knife all the way to the bone. Just like in the movie, his goal was to frame his mother and have her hauled away for child abuse. But when the police arrived, they told him that if he did press charges against his mother, he would end up in a juvenile home for the next 4 years until he turned 18. As seen in the movie, he decided against pressing charges and instead left home. He stayed at friends' houses. He slept in the back seat of their parents' cars, and in the book, he even mentions sleeping in the closet inside an apartment where two prostitutes lived until they got kicked out. The book is certainly worth a read if you want to learn more about Nikki's past, and I put a link to it in the description below. In the movie, the band is approached by an A&R rep from Elektra Records named Tom Zutaut. He's portrayed by SNL's Pete Davidson. And in the film, he comes up to the band at a bar, and in about 30 seconds, he signs them. This all feels way too impulsive in the film, but it was done to save time. In reality, they were very suspicious of Zutaut at that first meeting, and they made him buy them many free meals before they actually decided to sign. Now, as they become more popular as a band, we're witness to plenty of bad behavior in the movie. This includes them throwing a TV and furniture out of a hotel room window, which smashes into a car below. This actually happened when they were on tour in Germany. They threw the furniture, including the TV, out of the window, and it smashed into two Mercedes-Benzes down below. We also see them starting a fire in one of their hotel rooms. This is actually true. It happened when Vince Neil and Tommy Lee bought flare guns and fired one off inside their hotel room. It ricocheted off the walls before setting the bed on fire. They also broke the glass windows in the hotel's elevators. Perhaps one of the most memorable instances of bad behavior seen in the film is when they're hanging out poolside with Ozzy Osbourne. Ozzy gets down on his knees and snorts a line of ants. Mötley Crüe said that this indeed happened in real life, but when Ozzy was asked about the incident, he said he has no recollection of it actually happening. He doesn't remember ever snorting a line of ants. Mötley Crüe has recounted this story numerous times in interviews, and it's certainly possible that Ozzy was too drunk or high at the time to remember. Now, the culmination of the band's reckless behavior happens when Vince Neil gets into a drunk driving accident. It leaves his friend and passenger Razzle dead. This scene seems to be pretty spot on in the movie. They were indeed on their way home from the local liquor store, and Vince Neil was going close to 65 miles per hour in a 25 mile per hour zone, and his blood alcohol level was 0.17, which is well above California's then legal limit of 0.10. It had recently rained, and as they came upon a bend in the road, the gutter on the one side of the road had filled up, and it was draining water across the road to the gutter on the other side. As Vince Neil rounded the bend, his car hit the water and began to slide. He went into a 35-foot slide sideways and collided with an oncoming vehicle. The passengers in the other car were Lisa Hogan and Daniel Smithers. Lisa ended up in a coma and suffered brain damage. Daniel was placed in traction at the hospital and also suffered brain damage. Vince Neil was taken to a police station, and it was there that he was told that his friend, Hanoi Rocks drummer Razzle, was dead. It's true that people were upset over Vince Neil's rather light punishment. He was sentenced to just 30 days in jail, and he only served 19 of those days due to good behavior. He was also given 5 years probation in order to pay $2.6 million in restitution. Now, with regard to the whole car crash scene in the film, there's a technical detail that the movie does get wrong. In the film, we see Vince Neil driving what looks like a 1984 orange Corvette. In real life, he was not driving a Corvette. He was driving a 72 Ford Pantera. And it would have been cool to see the Pantera in the movie, because it's a nice looking car. It's also the reason that Razzle wanted to go along in the first place, because he wanted to see what it was like to ride in the Pantera. In the movie, we see Tommy Lee meeting Heather Locklear for the first time at the house party on the night of the accident. This is actually fictional. In real life, Tommy Lee first met Heather Locklear backstage at an REO Speedwagon concert. Tommy Lee and REO Speedwagon shared the same accountant, and the accountant introduced Tommy Lee to Heather Locklear. Now, what the movie does get right is that Tommy Lee did confuse Heather Locklear with Heather Thomas from the TV show The Fall Guy. At Tommy Lee and Heather Locklear's wedding in the movie, Nikki Sixx is almost too high on drugs to perform his best man duties. This is true, and in real life, Nikki says that he was even worse off. This is somewhat evident when looking at the wedding photo. This was a period of heavy drug use for Nikki Sixx, which led to his 1987 overdose, and that seems to be depicted pretty accurately in the film. He had indeed flatlined, and paramedics brought him back to life with 2 shots of adrenaline to the chest. He opened his eyes, and he saw the 2 needles sticking out of him. Like in the film, there was confusion over whether he had died, and Vince Neil recalls crying over hearing the news of his death, which fortunately turned out to be untrue. Like in the movie, the overdose wasn't Nikki Sixx's lowest point. He did get home from the hospital, and he shot heroin again, and he passed out on his bathroom floor. He woke up the next morning covered in his own blood. Another scene in the movie involving Nikki Sixx that's worth talking about is when Nikki fires manager Doc McGee. This scene is fictional. It's not how Doc McGee was fired in real life. Doc McGee never invited Nikki's mother for a surprise visit at Christmas time. In fact, the real Doc McGee says that he never even met Nikki's mother. In real life, Doc McGee was fired when the band was in Russia, scheduled to play at the Moscow Music Peace Festival in 1989. Tommy Lee had gotten into an argument with Doc McGee over why Bon Jovi had gotten to use stage pyrotechnics and Mötley Crüe hadn't. Mötley Crüe was also upset because they had been billed beneath most of the other acts at that festival. This included Ozzy Osbourne, The Scorpions, and Bon Jovi, who headlined the concert. Tommy Lee says that he pushed Doc McGee in his, quote, fat little chest, knocking him to the ground. Doc McGee was fired following the scuffle. In speaking of scuffles, there's a scene in the movie where Tommy Lee punches his one-time fiancé Honey in the face. It happens on a bus after Honey repeatedly calls Tommy Lee's mother a C-U-N-T. In the movie, Honey is upset because Tommy Lee's mother had called her a groupie. In real life, Tommy Lee's mother had accidentally called her Jessica on the phone. Now, Jessica was Bullwinkle's real name, and Bullwinkle was the woman at the beginning of the film involved in the lewd act. In real life, the incident didn't happen when they were on a tour bus. It happened when they were in a limo. Tommy Lee told the limo driver to pull over, and he kicked Honey out of the car. She resisted and started punching him. He dragged her from the limo onto the sidewalk and threw her belongings next to her. She continued to call his mother a C-U-N-T. It was then that Tommy Lee clenched his fist and punched Honey in the mouth. She dropped to the ground with her hand over her face. As they drove away, Tommy Lee recalls seeing mucousy strands of blood coming from her mouth as she spit teeth into her hand and onto the sidewalk. A&R rep Tom Zutaut asked the driver to stop. Zutaut got out and helped Honey collect her teeth. Like in the movie, it marked the end of her engagement to Tommy Lee. Throughout the film, we see Mötley Crüe's guitarist Mick Mars battling a rare spinal condition known as ankylosing spondylitis. He was first diagnosed with the condition at the age of 17, and it's a form of arthritis that mainly affects the spine and pelvis, and it manifests itself in severe discomfort and chronic pain. In advanced cases of ankylosing spondylitis, the inflammation can lead to the formation of new bone that causes various sections of the spine to fuse and become rigid. Mick Mars told actor A1 Rayon that it feels like your spine is turning into slow-drying concrete, slowly pulling you down. Now, the movie shows Mick Mars getting hip replacement surgery sometime around 1996, but in real life, Mars didn't have a hip replacement until 2004. Here again, the movie changes the band's timeline a little, and we see Nikki Sixx and Tommy Lee picking up Mick Mars from the hospital to go reconcile with Vince Neil. At this point, Vince Neil is still getting over the loss of his daughter to cancer. It's true that he did lose his 4-year-old daughter, Skylar, to a rare form of kidney cancer that affects children. The movie is very accurate in its depiction of this. Neil's daughter, Skylar, endured 6 operations and extensive chemotherapy and radiation treatments over the course of the 4 months following her diagnosis. Sadly, she ultimately lost the battle with the disease and passed away on August 15, 1995. Following her death, Vince Neil commented that this ordeal is something no parent should have to go through. Now, the reunion with Vince Neil happened much differently in real life. It wasn't this sentimental reunion at a bar. Instead, they were very reluctant to meet with Vince Neil, and they actually met up with him at a Hyatt with a team of lawyers and managers around them. The meeting was extremely tense, and after some urging, Vince Neil eventually agreed to stop by and listen to the record they had been working on. The movie also makes it seem like Vince Neil had been simply wallowing at the same bar the whole time he was out of the band. This is not true. He had actually tried to launch a solo career during the time he was not with the band. Now, the movie has the band trying to work out a deal with Elektra Records to gain ownership of their masters and publishing rights. In the film, they do this with the help of Elektra Records A&R rep Tom Zutaut. However, in real life, Tom Zutaut didn't have any involvement in this. By then, he had already left Elektra for Geffen Records. They were able to finally secure the publishing rights in 1998 after their album Generation Swine was a flop, and it took a long, grueling battle with Elektra head Sylvia Roan. Perhaps the Dirt's biggest error is by way of omission, and that's the omission of Tommy Lee's marriage to Pamela Anderson. The two married in 1995 after knowing each other for just 4 days. The marriage lasted until 1998, And during that time, the couple had two children together, and Tommy Lee served 6 months in prison for assaulting Anderson. Oh, and then there was the sex tape that the tabloids obsessed over. And after the marriage, Pamela Anderson blamed Tommy Lee for giving her hepatitis C. So the omission of Anderson is a significant deviation from the true story. And arguing that the relationship was outside of the movie's timeline isn't a very strong argument, because we do see events in the film that happened after 1995 when he married Anderson. Will there be a sequel? Who knows? There's definitely enough dirt on Mötley Crüe for one, and there's plenty in the book that wasn't included in the film. To learn more about what's true and what's false in the dirt, check out our article over on historyvshollywood.com that's linked in the description below. As always, if you enjoyed this video, be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel.